My name is Marco Baez. I've been a barber here in Elgin, established under my own business since 2014. When I first found out the news that we were gonna be shutting down, I was devastated. We were sitting here in the barbershop. It was a Saturday, March 21st, and I just remember the governor's press conference was on, and we were all sitting around seeing what was gonna happen. And the moment that he said that he was shutting everything down, my heart just dropped. And I just had a emptiness in my stomach, and I didn't know what I was gonna do, how I was gonna provide for my family, not knowing where we were gonna get the money to do groceries or to pay the bills. And a million things started to race through my head. I really had to just throw my hands up and kind of trust that it was all gonna work out, and that kind of had to listen to my wife telling me to just trust in the Lord and just calm down, everything was gonna be okay. So I've been at Harvest since 2013, and I'm super, super thankful for the people at Harvest. Just, we were getting meals at our house, we were getting groceries, we were getting gift cards. For grocery stores and stuff like that. And we were super blessed by that. They really helped us out. They really gave us some breathing room so we were able to take care of the essential things that we needed as a family. Being a barber, I work a lot of hours. Sometimes I work, most of the time I work late hours and I get home late. Don't really get to spend a lot of quality time with my family. So, what was going through my mind the majority of the time was, you're never gonna get a chance to have this time back again. Just being able to pour into my family, my kids, just giving them that time that I've never been able to give them before, just uninterrupted, zero distractions, just quality time. Also, during that time, I had a friend who was going through some things, and I was really able to dedicate a lot of hours to him, just being there and just walking alongside of him through the whole situation. So, which I know that I probably wouldn't have been able to do if I was working a full-time job and dealing with the family, so on and so forth. We were able to open up May 29th, and since then, the appointments were rolling in and people really wanted to get their hair cut. We've pretty much been back to about 75% of our normal business intake. So the Lord has been really good to us during this time. We have actually gained a lot of new business just for the precautions that we take, such as making sure that we're washing our hands after each client, washing all of our equipment, wearing masks. And the people really seem to appreciate that and want to give us their business because we care so much about their health and their safety when they come here. Most of all, what the Lord showed me was just to trust Him and just to really put all my desires in His hands and just to watch what He can do with it. And I was really excited to see all that the Lord had done for us in hindsight, just to look back at it and see how we made it through. So I'm very grateful for that.
All right, Harvest, I want to invite you to stand where you are. Let's engage the Lord in song, in spirit. Let's lift our voices to Him. Come on. Our praise awaits you with the dawn. Our souls awake to you and lift a song.
Amen.
We've seen the things that you have done, and still we know that the best is yet to come. Right, church? 'Cause there's more to come. Open the gates. Open the gates. Open our hearts and let our worship.
To worship you in spirit and truth. Church, let's lift up our voices and speak praise from the Word of God. Right now, all together, these words are on the screen. Sing praises to God. Sing praises. Sing praises to our King. Sing praises. For God is the King of all the earth. Sing praises with a psalm. God reigns over the nations. God sits on his holy throne. Colossians 1:13 said, he says, he has delivered us from the dominion of darkness and transferred us to the kingdom of his beloved Son. And so we respond together and say, for the Lord, the Most High, is to be feared, a great king over all the earth. He subdued peoples under us and nations under our feet. Thank you, Lord. You're the King of kings, the King of all kings.
In the darkness we were waiting without hope, without light, till from heaven you came running. There was mercy in your eyes to fulfill the law and prophets. To a virgin came the word, from a throne of endless glory to a cradle in the dirt. Praise the Father, praise the Son, praise the Spirit, be
the key.
keys forever and ever.
We give you praise
forever and ever
with our hearts and our minds and our strength and our soul. Reserve our souls to just give you praise. Psalm 103 says, bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name. Church, wherever you're gathered, out on the lawn in Elgin, in your homes, in cars, in other people's homes, God sees our church. He sees the people. But he is tuned in to the soul. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. All that is within Harvest Bible Chapel. Bless his holy name. Praise the Lord, O my soul. Praise the Lord. Sing that out, so simple. Praise the Lord, oh my soul. Praise the Lord.
My heart's cry.
We engage our souls for the Spirit of God. Praise the Lord.
We lift up a song.
Oh my soul.
We lift up a song.
Praise the Lord.
Church family, welcome to Harvest. We're so glad that you're worshiping with us this weekend. My name is Lynn, and I'm from the Elgin campus, and I'm honored to be your host this weekend. Hey, I want to start with just a very special welcome to any of you out there who are visiting Harvest for the first time. Would you do us a favor? Would you actually jump on the live prayer chat and on that feature and just let us know where you're watching from? It's been really fun to see how God has been drawing people from all over the globe to be with us. We'd also appreciate all of you, if you wouldn't mind, take a second and just check in. You can do that on your app, or you can do that right at the top of your screen. That would be fantastic. We'd appreciate it. And feel free to put down any prayer requests if you'd like us to be praying with you through the week. Well, a big shout out to our worship team. They've been traveling to all the different campuses hosting worship gatherings. You know, last Sunday we had the Elgin gathering, and I'm telling you, if we had been inside, I think we would have raised the roof. It was really wonderful to be back together and to be praising the Lord together. I feel for Meadows, because I think you guys were rained out last week, but you've got a new time, a new date. So this Sunday at 1 o'clock, we were going to be praying that the sun will be shining brightly for you guys, and no hail and no rain will be anywhere near. And Deerfield Road and Cathedral Campus, your worship gathering is Sunday as well at 4 o'clock. So don't forget to bring your lawn chairs. Your kids are welcome, and I pray that you just have a wonderful time praising the Lord together. Well, speaking of together, it's pretty fun to be able to talk with you about this special word, regathering. I'm sure you've actually already heard, but we are indeed regathering in our worship centers. It's going to be a little bit different on each campus, so make sure you check harvestnow.info for all the specifics for your location. And you know what? Don't worry. If you're not quite ready for this step, we're going to continue to live stream and you can watch as you've been watching every weekend. Well, it's my joy now to just read over you this passage from Psalm 18. I love you, O Lord, my strength. The Lord is my rock and my fortress and my deliverer. My God, my rock in whom I take refuge, my shield and the horn of my salvation, my stronghold. I call upon the Lord, who is worthy to be praised, and I am saved from my enemies. I also want to make sure that you who are sustaining us through your faithful giving, that you know how thankful we are. We appreciate every gift through this difficult season. I want to make sure that the rest of you know that there are actually four ways to give. You can give online, you can give through a text, you can give through your app, or you can just send your gift in the mail to the Rolling Meadows campus. We appreciate so much your hearts to give. Well, I'd like to just pray now and bow our heads. Oh Lord, you have indeed been our rock, and you've been our shield, and you continue to be our refuge day after day. Would you help us to view the world with all of its tensions through the framework of who you are, so we can focus on your power, your love, and your wisdom, because you alone are the one that hears our cries. So as we face the issues of our day, would you make us kind? Would you make us strong? Would you make us move to the whisper of your Spirit without hesitation? And above all, would you make us brave to bring the hope of the world to the chaos of our cities? Would you receive our gifts now, Lord? We just want to give to you because you are worthy of it all. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Continue to worship by praying. Father in heaven, we acknowledge what we just sang to you, that you are worthy, you deserve our praise. We've been reminded of that from what we've read from God's word, from what's been said, from what we have sung. And now, Lord, as we open up your word, we pray that that same attitude of our unworthiness and you being worthy will continue. We pray that you will just be present wherever it is that people are listening or watching. We pray that your spirit, wherever two or three are gathered, that we will sense and know that you are there. It's in the powerful name of Jesus that we pray. Amen. Back in the 1950s, there was a young man studying for the ministry. His name was Earl Palmer. He was a seminary student at the time at Princeton Theological Seminary in New Jersey. And at the end of the semester, he and his buddies wanted to drive all the way back to California. And so they started the long 3,000-mile journey westward. They would take turns in an attempt to try to keep a fresh driver. But during the middle of the night, when they were in Iowa, one of the guys who was driving got off at an exit to get gas. But the only station that was open was on the other side of the street, and so he made a U-turn, he filled up the tank, and then he awakened the next driver. The new driver, a little bit groggy, started driving, and he got back on the interstate. The only problem was he didn't get clear instructions from the previous driver, and so he proceeds to drive in the wrong direction. He drives straight east for about 3 hours, and he passed up some pretty obvious signs, signs like a welcome to Illinois sign that you can relate to, and yet it still didn't register that he was heading east instead of west. But then all of a sudden, directly in front of him, he saw the sun coming up, and it was too big of a sign for him to ignore. So they changed directions and they began heading west. Earl Palmer said they spent the rest of the trip to California arguing over whether they lost 3 hours time, 6 hours time, or 9 hours. By the way, for those of you playing along at home, the correct answer is six. Now that story may remind you of a similar one. Let me take you back to a weekend some 2,000 years ago. There were 11 disciples in particular, seminary students of a different sort, who were having second thoughts, disoriented by doubt, uncertain of where to go or what to do, groggy and grief-stricken, to say the least, as Jesus, the one who they thought was the Messiah, was now hanging on a cross. But on the third day, when they saw the sun come up, it was too big of a sign to ignore. Resurrections have a way of changing things, especially the direction your life is heading. And when the Son of God came up from the grave, he was validating his deity, and he was giving those who follow him hope for life beyond this one. What a transformation from Friday to Sunday. If you haven't done so already, I want to encourage you to take your Bibles out, and I want you to turn to Mark chapter 15. We've been working our way through the Gospel of Mark, and we're almost to the end of it. And in Mark chapter 15, we're going to take a look at that weekend when man was at his worst and when God was at his best. And today what we're going to do is we're going to see three significant stages. And the first stage was when Christ's death was confirmed. His death was confirmed. It was witnessed by others. We pick the story up in Mark chapter 15, verses 42 and 43. And when evening had come, since it was a day of preparation, that is, the day before the Sabbath, Joseph of Arimathea, a respected member of the council, who was also himself looking for the kingdom of God, took courage and went to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus Christ. First, let's understand the timing that is taking place here, because Mark goes to extreme measures to make certain that we understand. He clearly lays out that Jesus was crucified on Friday. The day of preparation is the day before the Sabbath. The Sabbath is on Saturday. We think of the beginning of a day as the minute after midnight. We say at 12:01, that's when the day started. But back then, they viewed it as actually starting at sundown a few hours earlier than that. So it might have been at 7 o'clock or 8 o'clock whenever the sun went down. And since the Jews had strict laws about the Sabbath, a body would have to be taken down from a cross before sunset on Friday, because the duties of getting it down and cleaning the body would constitute working on the Sabbath. And so after Jesus dies, someone has to quickly intervene, otherwise the Romans will keep him hanging up there for a couple of days. And that someone had better have some clout, because they're going to have to pull some strings with Pontius Pilate, the governor. And that someone is Joseph of Arimathea. And he steps up to the plate. And there's risk involved in approaching Pilate, because Joseph has a good reputation. But at this point, he doesn't seem to care. He feels compelled to do something to show some allegiance to Jesus. Luke chapter 23:51 tells us that Joseph of Arimathea did not consent to what the rest of the Sanhedrin had voted on, this mock trial of Jesus. Matthew's gospel tells us that Joseph was quite wealthy. John's gospel in John chapter 19, verse 38, describes Joseph with this phrase, a secret disciple for fear of the Jews. Evidently, seeing Jesus die changes his desire to blend in, and now he decides to come out as a Christ follower, as a Jesus sympathizer. And his boldness swells, and he goes straight to the powerful governor who earlier that day gave orders for Jesus to be crucified. Now, before we get very far away from that verse and that phrase, I feel like I need to stop and just say that there have been many times in my own life when I think that someone could describe me as a secret disciple for fear of his friends, as a secret disciple for fear of society and what they might think of me. And at times we can all succumb to being hypocritical, trying to be a Christian who wants to feel comfortable with the world and also with the church, with darkness and also with light. And I'm not proud of those moments when I've wilted rather than awakened. Let me tell you about Steve Ropecki. Steve Ropecki is a Christian businessman in Southern California, and one day he was attending an insurance convention, and there was a man that was addressing this conference, and there was a large crowd there, and the man who was speaking, as he kept talking, he continued to take the Lord's name in vain, and he would flippantly swear and just say, Jesus Christ, in a very dishonoring way. And finally, this Christian man, Steve Ropecki, could take it no more, and he got up and he stood up on top of his chair and he pointed his finger at the speaker and he said, you leave Christ out of it. And he got off his chair and he sat back down. And the stunned man resumed speaking, but he didn't take the Lord's name in vain anymore. And the amazing thing was that after that session was over, more people came up to shake Steve Ropecki's hand than they did the man who delivered the speech. There will be times when, because of your faith, you will need to stand against the crowd and come out of hiding and boldly let your coworkers in the break room or let your neighbors at the barbecue or let your loved ones at the family reunion know of your personal relationship with Jesus Christ. Their response may be one of respect, or it may be one of rejection. But regardless, you will have pleased your Lord and Master. You will have pleased the audience of one, and he is the only one. He's the only one whose opinion truly matters. Something happened to Joseph during Jesus' time on the cross. And whatever it was, it motivated him to honor Jesus by going to the governor. And if you think of it, it's pretty gutsy of him to do that, to put his reputation on the line with the other Jewish leaders. Why did he do it? He did it because for some reason he began to realize that there was something different about Jesus. There was something distinctive, and he wanted to honor him. We pick up our story in our text in verse 44. Look with me in verse 44. Pilate was surprised to hear that he should have already died. Now, we'll stop right there because a more accurate rendering of this verse is actually in the footnote of the ESV version where it says Pilate wondered whether Jesus had already died or if he had died a while ago is another way to interpret it. We pick it back up in verse 44 and verse 45. And summoning the centurion, he asked him whether he was already dead. And when he learned from the centurion that he was dead, he granted the corpse to Joseph. So he gave Joseph now the permission. But notice what he does before that. He calls the centurion. Pilate wants to know the expert opinion. The centurion will tell him whether or not this man has expired. He is the professional. The centurion saw last breaths more than any doctor ever would. His job caused him to be present as a person slowly died of suffocation in a matter of hours. And on that day, the credible conclusion that the centurion and his soldiers all came to was that Jesus was dead. In fact, Jesus had been so different and distinctive throughout his life, and now it even continues even in his death. So much so that the centurion who sees death on a regular basis says, truly, this man was the Son of God. What did the centurion witness during those 6 hours when Jesus spoke only seven sentences? Was it his expression of forgiveness to those who were killing him? I wonder, did Jesus lay down on the cross himself and not put up a fight, but instead laid down of his own desire and accord and stretched his arms out to make their job easier for them to put the nails in his wrists? I don't know, I'm just wondering. Because Mark's gospel speaks of the centurion and states, when he saw how he died. So what did he see during those 6 hours that prompted this calloused man to have a change of heart? And when Jesus died, the centurion just verbalizes this epiphany. He was the Son of God. And the centurion's job was to make certain that the criminal has died. And sometimes to expedite the process, they would break their legs so that they could no longer push upwards in order to get a breath of air. And we read in John's gospel that since the Sabbath was approaching quickly, the Jews got permission from Pilate to break the legs of the three men being crucified. Because if you can't push down with your legs, then you can't get that breath. And so the soldiers broke the legs of the other two people who were being crucified. And then they came to Jesus and they saw that he was already dead. So to make certain that he was dead, they did something. John chapter 19, let me read it to you, verses 34 and 35. But one of the soldiers pierced his side with a spear, and at once there came out blood and water. He who saw it has borne witness. Remember, John is right there next to Mary, the mother of Jesus. He's just a few feet away. Listen to it. He who saw it has borne witness. His testimony is true, and he knows that he is telling the truth, that you also may believe. This is eyewitness testimony. This was the period at the end of the sentence, the final nail in the coffin. Jesus was dead. The soldiers bear witness. The centurion bears witness. They're as knowledgeable as anyone. And John, standing right there, he bears witness. And medically speaking, when blood and water both come out together, the medical confirmation is that Jesus Christ has died. He was as dead could be. And so upon the confirmation between the centurion to the governor, on that basis, Pilate grants the corpse to Joseph of Arimathea, this respected citizen, for Christ's burial. Our suffering king has died a criminal's death. And that leads us to our next stage in this history-making weekend. His death was witnessed. And next we see that his burial was secured. No question, this is going to be a secure burial, maybe more so than anyone that you've ever heard of from that century. Look back in your Bible at Mark chapter 15, verse 46. Mark writes, and Joseph bought a linen shroud, and taking him down, wrapped him in the linen shroud, and laid him in a tomb that had been cut out of the rock, and he rolled a stone against the entrance of the tomb. So this implies that Joseph washed and cleaned Jesus' body. Washed and cleaned his body from all of the glass and the bone fragments from his scourging, from all of the dirt from walking up to Calvary, from all of the dried blood and the splinters from the crucifixion. And in that culture, a crucifixion communicated that you were cursed. And for Joseph to do all of this for a man who had just died the most degrading of deaths, a death that communicated to the culture that you were cursed, this was a labor of love by this rare and righteous religious leader. And Joseph would have anointed him in typical Jewish fashion with oil and then wrapped him in this linen cloth that he had just purchased. And the fact that Jesus, this criminal who was crucified for treason, was claiming to be the king, the fact that they would allow him to be buried in a tomb is extraordinary. Extraordinary. And it speaks more of Joseph's clout and wealth than it does of Jesus' connections. Back then, the The only people who owned tombs were the people that were very wealthy. The other 90-plus percent of the people were simply wrapped in a shroud and buried in the ground. It was easier to put the large stone in front of the tomb than it was to take it away, because it was disc-shaped, and they would let gravity kind of help to bring it downhill. They would put it in a trough, like in a groove, and that would be alongside the tomb, and so they would roll it kind of downhill into that place, and that's the way they would make a tomb. They would do it so that they could bring that there. And then to remove it, you would have to push it uphill, and you would have to go over a ridge that was there that kind of locked it in place, that it rested against. And Joseph put the stone there to keep the people out. Because as quickly as things had changed in the last 24 hours, Joseph wants to make certain, beyond any shadow of a doubt, that no one is able to get in there, that no one can do something destructive. And that morning, he remembered that there had been a frenzy with the crowd shouting, "Crucify him, crucify him." We pick it up in Mark chapter 15, verse 47. Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of Joseph, saw where he was laid. So they saw where the tomb was. They knew exactly where Jesus was. Remember those ladies? More on that later. And now the tomb is closed, and unbeknownst to Christ's followers, the Jewish religious leaders take one more step just to ensure that the dead body is protected. And the Sanhedrin appeals to Pilate to have his seal placed upon the tomb, and to also have a group of Roman guards posted at the tomb for the next few days. And I want to make certain you get this. It's in Matthew chapter 27, in Matthew's account, in verses 62 through 66. This is very important. So stick with me on this. The next day, that is, after the day of preparation, the chief priests and the Pharisees gathered before Pilate and said, "Sir, we remember how that impostor said, while he was still alive, 'After 3 days I will rise.' Therefore, order the tomb to be made secure until the third day, lest his disciples go and steal him away and tell the people he has risen from the dead, and the last fraud will be worse than the first." And Pilate said to them, "You have a guard of soldiers. Go, make it as secure as you can." So they went, and they made the tomb secure by sealing the stone and setting a guard. Now, this seal would be an imprint. It would be an impression. It would be the seal of the governor. It is indicating that the tomb was under the authority of Rome. It was under the protection of Rome. You mess with this tomb, if you mess with this, that seal will let you know that you're going to pay dearly. There will be a price to be paid. Now, what's funny, or maybe a better word is what's more ironic, is the fact that the enemies of Jesus were remembering his promises of resurrection, and yet it wasn't even on the minds of Christ's followers. Which leads us to the final stage of the weekend, and it's the game changer. And it's the one that will show the power of God and the love of Christ. And it's our final point. His resurrection was miraculous. It was miraculous. Look at the beginning of the next chapter. This starts our final chapter in our study of Mark. Mark chapter 16, verse 1. "When the Sabbath was passed, Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James, and Salome bought spices so that they might go and anoint him. And very early on the first day of the week, when the sun had risen, they went to the tomb, and they were saying to one another, 'Who will roll the stone away for us from the entrance of the tomb?'" Now, if you are observant, you may have noticed that this is the third mention of these ladies in just 8 verses. And Mark is putting them there for a reason. Because these women were witnesses to all that has happened on this transformative weekend and what is about to happen at the garden tomb. Why does he make certain that we know that? Well, as biblical scholar Richard Bauckham points out, this is just another way that Mark is letting us know that he is recording a historical account. This is not some story that he's just kind of thinking it over and saying, "Oh, I'll put this." No, he is writing it down as history. This is fact. This is not fiction. And Mark is saying these women, evidently they were still alive when he wrote the gospel. These women, you can find them. He's giving us a roadmap. He's saying, you check it out with them. Here's names and addresses to validate that this unbelievable story is actually quite believable. You remember when you were in high school or college and you had to do a term paper and they would say you have to have six different sources that you use. And then you would have to credit those sources and you would footnote and you would give all of those different things and you would cite them and you would attribute quotes to them. That's what's going on here. It's kind of like the names of these people are Mark's footnotes for us. And he is begging. He is begging his readers to check it out. You check out the sources. Look at verse 4. And looking up, this is the ladies coming to the tomb, and looking up, they saw that the stone had been rolled back, and it was very large. I love the fact that Mark is giving us specific details. He writes like a historian. We move on with verse 5. And entering the tomb, they saw a young man sitting on the right side, dressed in a white robe, and they were alarmed. And he said to them, "Do not be alarmed. You seek Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified. He is risen. He is not here. See the place where they laid him? But go, tell his disciples and Peter that he is going before you to Galilee. There you will see him just as he told you." This is the most exciting news to ever be announced. I mean, this ranks up there with Christmas, when we think of when angels announced to the shepherds that God had left heaven for earth and that he had moved into the neighborhood as a baby named Jesus. And now this angel sitting in an empty tomb is announcing he has risen. And these women are at the lowest point of their lives. And now they hear this miraculous news. And that's the transformation that Jesus can bring for every one of us. The resurrection of Jesus Christ changes the way that we approach every day of this earthly life. I've gone to Israel and taken groups of people there numerous times. Several years ago, I took a group, and the same thing happened. They all grew spiritually by leaps and bounds. The scriptures came alive to us in a new way. But on the last day of the trip, we visited the garden tomb. Now, they're very careful not to say that this is the actual tomb of Christ where he was buried. I mean, no one knows that, and no one would be so foolish as to make that type of a claim. But it would have been somewhere in that vicinity and in that region. And so it's a very meaningful, and it's a very peaceful place. And it's not so much that was the tomb, but it's the fact that you see there an unused tomb from the first century, and you get a chance to walk in it, and it's a very surreal experience, and it's a very spiritual experience because of what it represents. And as our group, we were taking turns going into the tomb in groups of three or four people. One of our older ladies in the group, when she walked into the tomb, she accidentally tripped over the lip that was there down at the bottom, and she tried to catch her balance, and she spun around, and she fell backwards, and she landed right on her back, and she hit her head really hard on the stone. And we all outside heard her head hit, and it was a very tense moment for our group. And one of the ladies in the group was a nurse, and she came in, and I came in, and I prayed with Erlene, and fortunately, she was all right. And after a couple of minutes, we were able to get her up, and she walked out, and she had a good nature and good sense of humor about it. And when we came out, our group, we immediately went into a worship service right there at the garden tomb, and we had a time of communion as we just kind of overlooked the garden tomb. And I preached a sermon, and in my message, I kidded Erlene, and I said, "You know, there have been tens of thousands of people who have walked into that tomb, but only two people have ever laid down in there." But the good news is that both of them got up and walked out. And that's true. That's not wishful thinking. The resurrection of Jesus Christ is not some concocted myth to fool ourselves into feeling good at funerals. No, Jesus conquered death. It was no match for him. And because Jesus walked out of his own grave, it has implications for everyone who accepts Jesus as their master and as their savior. Several of the gospel writers comment about the size of the rock that was placed in front of the tomb. And I love the fact that they talk about this. And the reason that's important is because it stands out. This was not just any old rock that was put in front of it. It was an exceptionally large and heavy rock that was placed there. In fact, the word that's used, we get the word in English, mega, from it. And Mark says that there's an angel that's there, a supernatural being. He appeared as a young man dressed in a white robe. Luke describes it as dazzling apparel. And whenever an angel comes on the scene, the same thing always happens. His first words are, "Do not be afraid," or "Do not be alarmed." And in my own mind, in my heart, I truly think that the angels, they probably truly get a kick out of doing this, you know. And they tell their buddies, "I'm getting ready to go scare the daylights out of this person. Watch this," right? But this is what he says. He says, "You seek Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified." These are words of reassurance. These are not words of rebuke for the women. He's commending them for being there to honor him, but he's encouraging them, not scolding them. He's telling them the rest of the story. And since the tomb has no dead body in it, there could be different explanations for why there's no body in there. And so the angel explains what's taken place. And the next thing he says is, "He has risen. He's not here." And the angel functions as a divine interpreter for the scene that is right there in front of these women. He says, let me explain to you, all right? Jesus didn't fake his death. The disciples didn't steal his body. The women didn't go to the wrong tomb. And while a large stone succeeded in keeping people out, it could not keep Jesus in. Because the power of God is too strong. Think about it. A stone to stop the one who made the mountain. And the angel describes a bodily resurrection. And Jesus' life and ministry is going to continue on. This is astounding news for these ladies. And in God's infinite wisdom, Mark, under the guidance of the Holy Spirit, records for us that the women are foundational witnesses to all three parts of this life-changing weekend: the death, the burial, and the resurrection. And one of the greatest proofs of the Bible is that it doesn't read like a lie. I mean, if we were trying to make up a story and fabricate a myth, you wouldn't have women being the ones to hear the angel's announcement. You wouldn't have Jesus' first appearance in the flesh to be to a woman in the garden. You say, well, why not? Because sadly, back in the first century, society didn't see a woman as a credible source. They were not permitted to give testimony in a court of law. In all honesty, they were just a few rungs above an animal in that culture. But not in God's eyes. Look at the last verse of our text, Mark chapter 16, verse 8. "And they went out and they fled from the tomb, for trembling and astonishment had seized them. And they said nothing to anyone, for they were afraid." And that's understandable at that moment. I mean, they are in shock as they leave. They're trying to process this unexpected turnaround that's taken place. They go to a funeral, and instead a celebration and bewilderment breaks out. And soon the deceased will be seen by them. And Mark writes, they said nothing to anyone. And the way it's written, it literally means they didn't say nothing to nobody. Now, that's putting it so that a Kentucky boy can understand it. But as we'll find out next week, their silence is short-lived, because they go back to the disciples, and in that familiar setting, that's when they open their mouths with their friends and they tell the story, only to be accused of hallucinating and of dreaming up a scenario in order for them to cope with their grief. But soon enough, they will all see him, and they will know that the suffering king has become the resurrected king. And Jesus, just Jesus, is the King of Kings, and he's the Lord of Lords. And that miraculous weekend has implications for you today. Since Jesus conquered the grave, if you put your trust in him, you can also conquer the grave. The sun coming up is too big for you to ignore. Next week, we will wrap up our walk through the book of Mark, and you may notice that in your Bible, it probably has a footnote that raises some questions about the validity of the remaining few verses in Mark chapter 16. And so we'll talk about that controversy, and we'll see some different opinions on the last verses in Mark, and we'll look at what the other Gospels write about Jesus following his resurrection. And next week, hopefully, we'll also share some videos from you, ones that you all will hopefully send in to us. And so we're inviting you to make a 15-second or less video on your phone. And what we want you to do is just to think back of all the things that you have learned through the Gospel of Mark. Maybe look back at your notes. Perhaps just try to find some truth or some takeaway or some tidbit that you learned in the Just Jesus series. Maybe it's a favorite verse. And all you have to do is just tell us your name and your campus. We'll put the website up here. It's easy for you to send this to. Just go to harvestbiblechapel.org/justjesus. And it has the directions, and it's very easy for you to send that to us. But remember, 15 seconds, okay? So it would go, here's a sample. I'm Dave Stone. I'm from the Elgin campus, and throughout this series, I have been reminded that Jesus has all authority. Not some, not a lot, but all authority. Now, that was 14 seconds, all right? You can rewind if you need to test me on that. But I have great confidence that you can do this. That's next week. But this week, today, what we've done today is we have looked at the gospel. The word gospel literally means good news. What's the good news? In 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 1, it says, here is the gospel, and it tells us what the gospel is in verses 3 and 4. This is what it says, that Christ died for our sins in accordance with the scriptures, that he was buried, that he was raised on the third day in accordance with the scriptures. That's the good news. The cross reveals God's heart for you and God's hope for you. His heart is to be in relationship with you, and his hope is that you would live in relationship with him. And it's his death, his burial and resurrection, which makes that relationship possible. Let's pray. Father in heaven, will you forgive us for those times when we have been a secret disciple for fear of our friends or for fear of family or for fear of society? Would you help us to grow in boldness and in obedience to tell the world the story of that weekend 2,000 years ago that changed everything? And we thank you for Jesus, the one whose death was verified and whose burial was certified and whose resurrection was glorified. And we praise you. We praise you for making it possible for us. I praise you for making it possible for me. We praise you for making it possible for us to have a relationship with you. And it's in the powerful name of Jesus that we pray. Amen.
Praise the Father. Praise the Son. Praise the Spirit. Three.
Amen and amen. What an amazing message for us this weekend. Now as you go, have a great week. And remember that you are loved.